Fair where Mom's apple pie reigns supreme, the state fairs and grand champions. But each seems to have a tradition of speed. Maybe Barney Oldfield started it in the first quarter century of the last 100 years. This is the American Speed Association live at the Minnesota State Fair. Hi, everybody. I'm Larry Newbern. We have a real points war heating up in ASA. The first two positions, Mike Eddy and Bob Seneker, well, those two drivers have won 10 of 14 races, and they're separated by less than 40 points. And in point of fact, nobody in the top 20 is in a stable position. Well, joining me on this broadcast is Rob Albright, the catalog of ASA track facts. Okay, Seneker tells me that wins are more important to him, that championships aren't that big. Mike Eddy seems to be the man most adept at winning these championships, so who is outpsyching whom?
I think that question really, Larry, is irrelevant. These two guys ended a season-long feud right here last year. They've been pals off the racetrack this season until 2 weeks ago, a race at Berlin Raceway, Marne, Michigan. Friction between the two of them, and we may see some more of that today.
Well, they're the headline story to be sure, but everybody seems to think, well, maybe Scott Hansen is on a roll as we come to Minnesota.
Well, Scott is certainly one of the strong up-and-comers. The way I perceive it, it's the two old foxes still leading the way, but the young hounds are closing on them rapidly. Hansen, Benson, Sauter, Tony Raines right there in the points battle as well.
Well, to be sure, we're in Hansen country. He's from the Northland, but whenever you get north of Chicago in a stock car, you're definitely on Dick Trickle's turf, and guess what? Dick Trickle is on the pole. He's standing by with our Ralph Shaheen.
What's really unique about racing here at the Minnesota State Fairgrounds with the ASA is it's the only time race cars actually hit this pavement. When they came out here this morning, it was very dusty, a lot of loose pebbles. But the one guy who figured the whole trek out quickly was Dick Trickle. He did a masterful job of it, only 45 minutes of practice. Dick, what is it about you and your driving style that allowed you to figure out this racetrack so fast today?
Well, it couldn't have anything to do with the fact that I ran this track since the early 70s, and, you know, the ASA competition is tough, so I'm pretty proud to sit on the pole. I mean, it isn't easy, and it was by a short margin. And, you know, it's the same track. It's been here forever. It's a really neat little track. They took the pond out of the infield. Other than that, it's the same pavement we've run on forever, and it's held up well. And, you know, I'm just proud to be sitting on the pole and enjoying coming up to the north here and getting to race with my fellow competitors from the past and obliged a few of my fans.
You've visited with us a couple of times so far this year. Is that knowledge enough to win and beat this competition? You yourself mentioned it is stiff.
Well, it's going to be a race, there's no doubt about it, but I figure I'm in contention to win as probably another 10 guys are, but you know, that's the deal where I do have a good car, and you know, Goodyear has a good tire, and Dylan built me a good chassis here, and you know, Wagner Engineering's got me a good motor, and I've got a little experience of my own, and my crew, who I've designated responsibility to, they prepared the car because I'm in Darlington yesterday and Saturday, and just been on the road and down south a lot, so my crew will deserve a lot of credit if I win this race because they prepared the car just to that point.
Well, Rob and Larry, when it comes to black books of knowledge, Dick Trickle has a thick one.
Ralph, it's a special day in the state of Minnesota. It's state fair time. The Vikings and the Twins played yesterday and today, front stage and center, the American Speed Association, and 15,000 horsepower roars to life. 90,000 pounds will soon be hurtling around this one-half-mile racetrack. It's state fair time, and it's American Speed Association time at the Minnesota State Fair. There's Mike Eddy. You'll be riding with Tim Steele. We'll be back with the starting grid and the green flag in just a moment. Although Seneca and Eddie have dominated the ASA competition this year, this is a special field today. It's power-packed, Rob. There are a number of people who could win. Let's talk about the conditions.
It's a tremendous day for racing. 82 degrees, the humidity comfortable. The race fans are dressed for the occasion this afternoon. The forecast, cloudy skies, which should bode well for the drivers. And now we've got a race-level view. You can see how narrow pit road is. Pit road could be a decisive factor in the outcome of the race today. It will be extremely treacherous for these drivers getting in and out of the pits. The track is really a perfect oval in configuration, 700-foot long straightaways. The turn's extremely wide, 600 feet in length. The banking, just very slight, 5 degrees on the straightaways, 12 degrees on the turns. A track that is really only utilized for competition one day a year right here.
Here is today's starting grid. Beginning on the pole from Wisconsin is Dick Trickle. He's alongside of the all-time winningest driver from Michigan in ASA, Bob Seneca. It's the Badger Battalion versus the Michigan Monster.
And last week's winner from Anderson Speedway in the Baker Enterprises Delta Faucet Chevrolet from Green Bay, Scott Hansen, and the Fleet Ford, the rookie, Tim Fedewa, the DNR Racing Babcock Thunderbird.
Mike Eddy will start on the inside of row number three in his Nationwide Auto Parts Pontiac, and on the outside is Glenn Allen Jr. in the Delco Voyager Chevrolet.
Going in row number four, the ebullient Gary St.Amant from Columbus, Ohio. He drives the A1 Auto Service Ray Besta Chevrolet, and the sometimes ASA competitor, car number 93, John Ziegler from Madison, Wisconsin, and the all-car automotive Chevy.
One of the rising stars is next. That's Tony Raines in the NL Brokerage race car, and Johnny Benson, former Rookie of the Year out of Michigan, flanks him on his right.
The sixth row is comprised of Kent Stauffer from Elyria, Ohio, in the Flextech Kinetic Ford, and Harold Fair from Detroit, Michigan, the Mack Tool Chevy.
Joe Scheer will start on the inside of row number seven. He is a threat to win one of these races. He's out of Illinois, and Steve Burgess, who has also qualified well in the past in ASA, will start on the outside.
In the eighth row, the hobbled Tim Steele from Marr, Michigan, and the Texana Grill HS Dyan Engineering Chevy, and Dave Jackson from Cincinnati, Ohio, in the Red Bank Trout Dapper Chevrolet.
Row number nine is Jay Sauter and Mark Lamoureux. The 10th row is Jeff Neal and Kenny Adams. In the 11th row, the 21st and 22nd starting positions, Ted Musgrave. Watch for him to move to the front. He practiced better than he qualified. Dennis Lampman passed a lot of cars in ASA this year. And in the 12th row, Kenny Wallace. Yes, the same one visiting from Busch Grand National Racing. Brother Rusty is in the pits as crew chief. And Terry Baldry, one of the top-ranking rookies, follows. Then comes Tom Harrington, an ASA vet. Todd Forbes, he's had one of the fastest Fords this year. And John Olson and Tom Jones are rounding out row number 14. The last four starters in today's race, Bruce Vanderlaan, a top five car. The last race at Anderson, along with Dennis Vogel, Dean South, and John Wilson. Those neighbors from Ohio are side by side again, as they have been so often this year.
Well, in case you're wondering why some of the familiar and famous names are well back in the pack, it's because that this is the compressed day of the year for ASA. Practice qualifying racing all one day. And now you're riding with Gary St.Amant in that Ray Besta Chevrolet. Gary, certainly one of the favorites here this afternoon. He's been one of the fastest drivers all season long. Youngster from Columbus, Ohio. And there's Tim Steele's car number 85. We mentioned that he was hobbled. Tim was injured in our last televised event. Now you're riding with Tim in the Texan Grill HNS Dodge Chevy.
We will go 300 laps at the Minnesota State Fair. Dick Trickle brings the field around, eyeing the starter. The green flag is waving, and the Minnesota State Fair is underway. Everybody executing corner 22 perfectly. No wall contact, but Johnny Benson appears to be rolling to a stop. We could see an early caution flag. There is Benson hobbling down toward the inside of the back straightaway. He doesn't look like he's going to make it. Meanwhile, Dick Trickle has led lap number one. The rest of the field still very competitive on the track. And we've got a problem in corner number one. One, two, three, four, five cars are involved. There is Dennis Vogel. Jeff Neal looks like he's got serious damage up front. Jay Sauter. Looks like Kenny Adams
and Terry Baldry. Five of the regulars in the American Speed Association this year have come to a very rude meeting in corner number one.
Well, tremendously disappointing, obviously, for all of those drivers and their fans. Kenny Adams is driven away from the scene of the incident in car number 86, and Dennis Vogel is also under power.
Let's see if we can figure out what happened. I think the incident has already occurred up front. There's Neal in that white number 5 trying to avoid Sauter. He appears to be sideways in front of the rest of the field all by himself. Kenny Adams
has gotten involved as well. It appeared that Jay Sauter, we got in a little bit late, it appeared that Jay Sauter had spun, precipitating the incident. Whether or not he made contact with another race car, I'm not certain. Jay has a brand new engine in this car this weekend, and he thought this would be a good race for him.
Now, we're riding with Tim Steele. This is other action on lap number one.
You can see Dave Jackson in car number 45 giving a wide berth to, it appears,
Joe,
to be
Shear.
Joe Shear's car number 36, and look at Shear drop to the bottom side of the racetrack.
Wow.
As we started to say, this is a day that puts tremendous pressure on these drivers, Larry. They come through the pit gates at 6 o'clock in the morning. Unlike all of our other events, where qualifying and practice take place the day before, we're doing it all at one time here.
Well, Ralph is standing by with John Benson, who has stayed seated in the cockpit. Ralph, what's going on down there?
Well, his crew has gone to work feverishly on the car. Johnny, any idea what the problem is?
It broke the drive shaft and ripped it around off.
Okay, yeah, I guess drive shaft broke in half and I tore the rear end out of it. I don't know. It's pretty sad to have that happen on the first lap.
Well, this crew struggled earlier. You heard Chip Caputo come lean right in and tell him. They struggled earlier, got the car going, and it only completed half a lap.
Same thing happened to Harold Fair this morning. As a matter of fact, after practice, there were about 6 cars disassembled in pit road. This could be a very long day for ASA. Normally, State Fair time is just a glorious moment in the life of anybody that attends, but the American Speed Association race has been interrupted on lap number 2 with a massive pileup in corner number 1. At least 5 cars were involved. Let's make that 6. There's Kenny Adams. You can see a severe damage to the tail. We've also noticed Ted Musgrave punched somebody. His right front fender and the hood was damaged. So lots of people involved. There's Jay Sauter, who seemed to be the man who set this thing off. Ralph is reporting on what's going on down there.
Well, Larry, you can see the crew is going like crazy around this car trying to get Jay Sauter back in there. If it is fixable, Jay, what happened up there?
Well, I think the guys were just getting over-anxious too soon. I really feel bad for the Stacy Motorsports Sauter Race Cars Weir Chevrolet team. They worked super hard all week. The car was torn up at Anderson last week. We salvaged a 9th place finish. We worked hard. The motor was great. It was back from Ruggles. Car looked great, and everybody was anxious. I don't know who was behind me. Somebody tagged me, spun me around, and nobody else had any place to go. It was just one of those accidents you couldn't avoid.
You know, we've seen crews rebuild race cars to get them back into the action. How bad can a race car be torn up before you're completely out of it?
Well, I've got one of the best crews in racing, so if it's possible, they'll get it fixed. We're 5th in points right now, and we need to be out there making laps, and if they can get the job done, we'll be back out there.
I don't think you need to say anything else than that, Larry. This crew is going to work.
Jay Sauter trails John Benson Jr. in 4th, Scott Hansen in 3rd, and Eddie and Seneca almost tied for 1st place. Now we're looking at Jeff Neal. Sauter, incidentally, has had 5 top 10 finishes in a row.
And that Jeff Neal Z-Rex machine is the one that started directly behind Jay Sauter on the grid. And you can see some damage to the nose piece of that automobile. So it's conceivable, but conjecture on our part, they might have made contact. Real disappointing for Sauter. His car owner, Chris Weiss, as we look at Todd Forbes right there in car number 07, that one has also been damaged.
It's been one of the fastest Fords this season. Let's take one more look at the accident. You can see that Kenny Wallace in that black number 2 takes evasive action. Nowhere for Neal to go. There's Baldry roaring in and plowing into the left front of Sauter almost simultaneously with the rear of Jeff Neal.
I noticed at the very top of the screen, Ted Musgrave, who started one row behind Neal, was already ahead of those two drivers. So it's obviously something happened just before we were able to catch him.
And during break, Rob, it was you who pointed out that Musgrave does have damage to the right front. So you just can't tell. There is Terry Baldry's car. Remember, this is the guy who plowed head-on into that incident. Musgrave, he's a suspect right now, but he's not a convicted criminal yet, Ralph.
what, Larry, you know, when you work the pits like this, you know how it is. Usually you figure the first couple laps, you sit back and wait for everything to get started. Well, they got us started in a hurry down here. As you're watching this follow Terry Baldry's car back, you can see all the damage to the front there. It's pretty well torn up and leaking a lot of fluid, what looks like, out of the radiator. A lot of damage to the right side of the car, too. Lucky for Terry, since he's sitting on the other side. So we're going to try and track down a few more of the other drivers and see how everybody's doing, and we'll get back to you in just a minute.
Well, Terry's from up here in the Northland. He's from Umro, Wisconsin. He was the rookie of the race, the last race at Anderson, and the last time he was able to pull that off was the very first race of the year, so he has been one of the stronger rookie challengers all season long. And of course, all the drivers from the Wisconsin, Minnesota, Northern Illinois area, when they race up here, there's a lot of pride going. They like to do well, so it's pretty crushing to someone like Terry.
Terry, one of four rookies vying for the Pat Shower Memorial Award this season. And much of the season, Shower, Fedewa, Tim Fedewa, Kenny Adams, three of those four rookies have run right together on the racetrack.
Ralph has Terry Baldry. Ralph?
Terry, as simple as wrong place, wrong time?
Pretty much, I think. I don't know. I really don't know what happened up front, but I tried getting slowed down in front of me, and I got hit from behind and just got pushed into it. Got her on both ends now. Ain't looking too good.
Well, 12 laps have now been recorded, and only one of those 12 has been green flag. Right now, we're getting the signal from ASA officials that we will be ready to go the next time around. Dick Trickle finds leading the first dozen laps of this race easy, but believe me, everybody's ready to go, and they'd rather be going at speed. It is Trickle. It is Hansen. Bob Seneca is third. Glenn Allen Jr. from Cincinnati, Ohio is fourth. Mike Getty is fifth. Tim Fedewa, the fastest Ford of this week, is sixth. Gary St.Amant is seventh. Tony Raines is eighth. Ken Stauffer is ninth. And Johnny Z, John Ziegler, is running in tenth. Green flag this time around.
We may see just a bit more patience on this restart for a number of the drivers as they file single file this time down the back straightaway, drop low into turn number three. Many of the drivers felt that you could not risk getting up out of the group here.
This track has been very precarious all day long. You mentioned it's a one-day event, something unusual in the ranks of professional racing. But we had a serious crash. The very first car that went out to qualify, Pat Bordeaux out of Saginaw, Michigan, he just deep-fried it going into corner number three, hit the outside wall very hard, destroyed that car. And I watched qualifying from up here in the broadcast booth, and a lot of drivers were having a very difficult time holding onto the handle on this track. It's circular in form and constant speeds all the way around.
One of the drivers alertly able to avoid that contact in turn number one was Kenny Wallace. He's making his way up through the pack as we once again look at the lead file. Dick Trickle all by himself out in front. One of just four former winners in the race this afternoon.
Dick Trickle, who is touting the colors of Jim Gruen Chevrolet, one of the local dealerships here in the Minneapolis area. And it does look as though that Scott Hansen, we told you at the top of the show, a lot of people feel that this guy has found new life here in the final 25% of the season. Scott Hansen running second, really putting the pressure on Trickle. Again, that's Seneca in third, and Glenn Allen Jr., who has been incredibly fast. Rob, you and I were talking earlier, Glenn Allen Jr. in that fourth running car, green and white car, has probably been the most consistently fast driver qualifying all year long.
He's also the front running of a three-car super team being fielded this weekend by Carl and Nick Vitt. He owns this machine, the disabled mount of Kenny Adams, and he also built the race car that Kenny Wallace is competing in today.
And remember, if you've not heard this story before, it's definitely worth repeating. Dick Trickle leading. We just flashed out of the screen. We're going back to looking at Glenn Allen Jr. right there. Dick Trickle on the far left. He has won, legend has it, well over 1,000. That's right, 1,000 races over in his career.
There's another Dick Trickle legend, and I learned it when I came to ASA a few seasons ago. That is, Dick gets 1 hour of sleep per 100 laps of the race. Although I'm thinking as he gets a little older, he may require just a bit more. I think he got maybe a little more than 3 hours last night. He's had a busy weekend.
Very complimentary of his crew this morning before the race began. He raced at Talladega, Darlington twice, and then flew overnight to get here. We talked to Dick before the green flag flew.
Well, I think just really keeping an eye on the chassis and, you know, trying to get your setup proper and keeping good records. You know, burning desire, you know, with the driver and the whole team, you know, that's, you know, they go home thinking about the car and I go home thinking about the car. And, you know, desire is a big part of this game. The guy that wants to spend the most time in will get the most out of it.
Triple came here last year as a visitor from the South also. Qualifying was rained out. He was relegated to a 26th starting position and worked his way up to 10th at the checkered flag.
Trickle opens up a little bit of daylight between himself and the second running Scott Hansen, and Bob Seneker begins to look like, well, he would like to make a move. Seneker appears to be getting a better hold of the racetrack, Rob. He's got a better line at least through 3 and 4, whereas Hansen is about a half a car length up.
Good battle shaping up for the 7th position between Tony Raines in car number 25 and Gary St.Amant in car number 7.
For second place, there is Seneker. I mentioned a moment ago that he appeared to be handling just a little better than Hansen. He goes to the inside of Scott. There's Glenn Allen Jr. waiting to see which one of these two veterans, although Hansen has not run that often in ASA compared to Seneker and Eddie, see which the two of them will come out on top in this battle.
Those are without question the two strongest cars in the race last week at Anderson, but Seneker brushed the wall at the midpoint of the race, was forced to make a 2-lap green flag pit stop, and he just fought his way back into the lead lap by the checkered. Hansen 1 week ago was totally dominant.
Remember, 300 laps to go. Dick Trickle has had things all to his own way so far in this race. And second place is very much up for grabs. It's side by side, Hansen and Seneker. Glenn Allen Jr. is still third in the green and white number 66. Every once in a while you see Mike Eddy. Remember, he has won more of these races this year than any other driver in the black and yellow number 88. As Seneker finally does slip by and Hansen falls back in line, he needs to protect his flanks.
Expect to see Glenn Allen and Mike Eddy challenging Hansen as well. Those two drivers ran right together last Saturday night through most of a 400-lap event. Now look how quickly Seneker begins to move away. Hansen is strong going into the corners, but Seneker's car seems to get a better bite off the turns and down the straightaway. And I think that may be a function of the selection of gearing that these drivers chose before the start of this race.
Bob Seneker has about a 40-point lead in the point standings over Mike Eddy. That's about 10 positions in the racetrack. We ask him, what's more important, wins or championships?
That's a tough question for me, because I still like to win races. I think the championship is probably still second in my mind. I want to win.
Well, as again we mentioned at the top of the show, Bob Seneker goes public by saying, the victories are more important to me than the championships. But with professional race drivers, you just really never know who's pulling whose chains.
Glenn Allen now beginning to challenge Scott Hansen for that third position. And as you said, Glenn has been consistently fast. He's won half a dozen pole positions this year, but only one win. That came in the opening race of the season at Columbus Motor Speedway, his home track. We'd certainly like to conclude our televised events this season with victory this afternoon.
Glenn has been more than plagued. He's been haunted by bad luck all season long. That car has been so fast, not only in qualifying, but also he's dominated a lot of the races, but they've had so much misfortune, it's almost hard to believe that he's run 30 laps of being fortunate.
You may have seen he had Scott Hansen almost sideways that time coming off turn two as they attempt to put a lap on Todd Forbes' fourth number, car number 07. Yet despite that, in his youth, at 20 years of age, he's been extremely philosophical about the problems that have plagued him. He knows if he just keeps at it, makes laps, get the experience, he's going to be the guy they'll be chasing in the future.
Third and fourth right there, Scott Hansen, Glenn Allen Jr., Eddie is fifth. In sixth right now is Tony Raines, having another, typically for 91, Raines solid race. The Ford of Ken Stauffer is in seventh. The other Ford of Tim Fedewa, qualified fourth, is in eighth. Gary St.Amant out of Columbus, Ohio, is in ninth. And Harold Fair is turning in one of his better races. He qualified reasonably well, 12th, but he's challenging for the top 10.
Glenn Ellen has picked up third position, and Mike Eddy wastes no time disposing of Scott Hansen. You noticed it took Glenn Ellen several laps. Mike Eddy just two turns around the racetrack, and he'll come to fourth behind Glenn Ellen Jr.
Possibly the difference between being a veteran and being a youth who's had a lot of misfortune, trying to be just a little more careful.
Well, it looks like Dick Trickle now is closing in on heavy traffic. And right in front of him is rookie Kenny Adam and another rookie, Dean South.
And the traffic is too oppressed, so Dick Trickle has quite a chore on his hands here in the next couple moments. We'll be back to follow his travail through the field after this. From Darlington to Minneapolis, St. Paul overnight, and to the American Speed Association's main event of the weekend lead, that's Dick Trickle. Dick Trickle qualified in the pole, and he has not given up that number one position. We are definitely in his neck of the woods, and Dick Trickle figures to be very strong today. He has not won an ASA race in 1991, but today be his first.
Also tries to do the same thing he did in 1987, beating Ted Musgrave. And there's Tony Raines. Tony has been moving very strongly lately. He just went by Scott Hansen a few minutes ago, and he appears to be closing on Mike Eddy and Glenn Allen Jr. That car extremely strong. Of course, Tony Raines formerly lived in northern Indiana. This is a brand new team affiliation. Ernie Roselli bought this car from Ray Dillon over the winter, and they have been a formidable competitor all season long.
Tony Raines, the former Boy Scout, who used to attend Boy Scout meetings in the basement of the church, which now houses ASA, has had a third place as his high water, make that a second place, as his high water mark of 1991. He appears to be moving in on the king of speed, or at least speed victories, Mike Eddy, in 1991.
Tony Raines has a tremendous ability with very limited experience to quickly figure out how to set a chassis up for a racetrack. Some have compared him in that regard to Bob Seneca. Others say he's like the legend short track racer Butch Miller. Whatever the case, he knows how to figure out a racetrack quickly.
Tony is still looking for career win number one in ASA. He's had a number of close calls this year. Actually put a second in the first race of the season in Columbus, Ohio, but I think we told you before, earlier this season, he was disqualified from that one, unfortunately. But he's had a series of thirds, fourths, and fifths. He's trying to break a string of bad luck. He crashed the last time out at Anderson, and he has not cracked the top 20 in those two races.
He's one of those drivers that generally during practice is setting his car up for the race, not particularly qualifying. So it's not uncommon to see him moving up as he is today early in the race.
A tricky, long half mile. We're high above the speedway, and from our vantage point, this looks like anything but a half mile, much closer to 5/8. And you look at the outside rail, where, of course, these cars are not running. That's not the racing route. It almost appears to be 3/4 mile around, similar to the Indianapolis Raceway Park. A very wide racetrack, lots of room to race, but there's something that's about it, about this racetrack. Cars don't seem to be able to get away from each other, and it appears to be very dangerous.
Well, what often happens when a facility is used infrequently, as this one is, where the cars run in the early part of the race, they run a low groove, and it's hard then to make that second groove come in. As the race develops, I think you'll see more and more lines being utilized around the racetrack. It'll make it much more racy as we go on this afternoon.
There's Tony Raines. You see the documentation of his best career finishes so far, a second, also his best finishes of the 1991 season. Young driver who really hopes to move up through the ranks in motor racing, and the next major hurdle for him is going to be winning one of these ASA races. But not only does he have Seneca and Eddy to beat today, but everyone's seeing, hey, they got to handle that guy from Wisconsin Rapids.
Tony does not any longer seem to be closing on Mike Eddy, nor is Eddy gaining on the car directly in front of him, Glenn Allen Jr., but all three of them are closing on the second place car, number 84, Bob Seneca.
Well, Mike Eddy, of course, was last year's champion, and he's again in the thick of the battle for this year. We ask him, well, what is the significance of the championship this year?
Yeah, what happened last year is last year, and you can't live on the past. You got to look to the future, and last year was last year, and hopefully this year will be different, but you never know what's going to happen.
Mike also had a string broken, I guess, by Scott Hansen. We would say last week at Anderson, he had led every one of these races since the first race, some 12 races in a row. He had had leading laps, dominated many of them, and last weekend Hansen was so strong that Mike never had a chance to lead.
Continue to watch Dick Trickle lead this race, and car number 99 qualified for the pole position and has led every lap so far in his Jim Bruin Racing Chevrolet. And to Dick's credit, he just runs two or three times in ASA competition each year now and always seems to be able to come out and figure a quick way around the racetrack. There is just no substitute for laps of experience. And I like the way Ralph said it. He's got a black book that's just full of information. He's got a good baseline when he comes to the track.
He was extremely well prepared when he came here today, as you might expect. Oh, there's a bump with Gary St.Amant as he bumps Dean South, trying to put a lap on the Dayton, Ohio driver. Dean holds on to his race car. St.Amant moves by, no wave of the hand or no apology. Gary St.Amant moves on his way.
Well, Gary came up on Dean rather quickly in car number 7. Now, he's not running all that well at this point. He's still in 7th position in car number 7, but has fallen off the leader's pace somewhat. Gary's a driver that probably could benefit from a pit stop and some fresh right side Goodyear.
You have a roof cam again this week. We'll see that in just a second. That white car, incidentally, just in front of St.Amant, is Scott Hansen, who was running with the leaders early on. There's a look at Gary St.Amant, relaxed, steering around this half mile. He called it a very long half mile.
As knowing that he has unusual to driving perspective, he's kind of leaned back in the seat. Most of the drivers sit more upright.
Here's Jeff Neal. Jeff Neal, the Xerox number 5, was involved in that lap number 1 crash. They've been searching since that, as you can see. He's working with a car that really is a wounded animal.
Well, Jeff got some disappointing news, I think, this week. The Z-Rex people probably will not be back for 1992, so he's looking for some new corporate support. This is a surprise to see Ted Musgrave in jeopardy of going the lap down this early in the race. Maybe a function of the damage that you see to the right front bodywork of car number 98. He was involved in that second lap incident.
Trickle and the leaders are really tearing around this half-mile oval. As a matter of fact, they are putting laps on a lot of cars which would not have expected it this early on. Dick Trickle, with 29 career wins, is looking to get number 30 today. Here is the top five after 65 officially of 300 laps. Trickle, Seneca, Glenn Allen Jr. in third, Mike Eddy in fourth, and Tony Raines in fifth. So a very nice representation of a variety of states.
As we watch Dick Trickle put a lap on one of our in-car camera machines, the car number 85 of Tim Steele. Now we'll look from the view that Tim sees. That's not the one that he wanted to be looking at this point of the race.
Tim Steele was one of many drivers who had all kinds of problems after practice and even leading into qualifying. Now we go up on the rooftop of Tim Steele's car. There's Tim Steele trying to keep pace with Dick Trickle. But there were about 6 cars disassembled between practice and qualifying. Tim Steele's was one of them, and Tim was right inside the engine compartment with the car up on jack stands, and they just barely got out in time to qualify.
Tim's racing hurt as well. He was injured in our last televised event at Jennerstown Speedway. Trickle continues to set the pace, and during the break, Larry, I think you made an observation that he is setting a torrid early race pace. I don't think anybody expected this.
Yeah, Seneca and Glenn Allen Jr. and Eddie are keeping up, but I don't think it's one that they necessarily would have liked to follow, particularly Seneca and Eddie, who are interested in the points. Now, we mentioned this track is used only once a year. That's got to be abrasive to tires, and Ralph's been following that story.
Well, it really is, Larry, and it really plays against what you were just saying about the torrid pace being set right now. These tires will be really slippery in the first few laps of this race, the early going, because there is no rubber laid down on this racetrack to give the car good grip. As they race around for a while, we'll lay some rubber down, the traction will come in, and the first set of tires will become no good. They'll have to come in and pit for tires. Fuel mileage isn't going to be a big question here today. Most of the crew chiefs say they can go well over 200 laps on this racetrack before they need fuel. But tires will go somewhere between 80 to 100 laps. And this torrid pace can decide how close to 80 or 100 we go.
And if they fall short of 100 laps, that could mean 2 stops for tires alone. And I think a lot of people would like to do this in one, but if the tires do go away that quickly, as Ralph just pointed out, no way.
Trickle continues to lead. You can see he's just put another lap on the zero of Tom Jones. one of the guys that's on the move through the pack, maybe we'll get a chance to look at him a little bit later, is the 90 machine of Kent Stauffer. He's coming. He's in sixth. He's the next car beyond our graphic that showed Tony Raines running in the fifth position. And right now, he is the forward most running for Thunderbird.
This is a very nice facility here on the Minnesota State Fairgrounds. We're actually in the city limits of St. Paul, Minnesota, but as many of you know, these are the Twin Cities, as in the Minnesota Twins. This racetrack, nice lawn in the infield. There's a small pond here, lots of evergreens, and it's truly like a state park, and it's one of the finest settings that you ever find for a half mile oval.
It has a tremendous ASA tradition. Several seasons ago, ASA would come here and run two or three races during fair week, and then would be interspersed with some open wheel contests as well. It's got to be disappointing to Minnesota area race fans not to get to see more action on this beautiful track.
Approaching about the one-third point, if you've got a favorite in ASA, look for them in this shot. You can see Eddie and Alan just went by. There comes Dennis Lampman, followed by Tony Raines, Tim Steele, Petty Musgrave in a two-tone blue car. There's Jeffrey Neal. There's one of the potent Fords running today, Peter, in that bright yellow car. Here's a look at the entire field here inside of the first 100 of 300 laps. There's Kenny Wallace in that other black and gold trim car. That is not Mike Eddy directly in front of Bob Seneker. That is Kenny Wallace. They hope to be very competitive here today, and now they are in jeopardy, too, of going the lap down to the flying Dick Trickle. Rob, I just can't believe that this is a pace that all the ASA regulars wanted to follow this early on.
I can't either. We're just a quarter of the way into this race. Still three-fourths of the event to go, and Trickle is just, he's on a roll. What is also surprising, despite the problems that we had in the first three or four laps of this race, since that time, we've run nothing but green flag racing conditions, and you can believe that Trickle is going to use it to take advantage to lap as many cars as he can.
He really is putting away a lot of people, putting them one lap down. There is the seventh running, Tim Bedewa, in the Babcock clutch and brake. Those colors have sprouted on that car. Again, this is one of the Ford Motor Company cars that they are eyeing, at least in the 1991 season, where there is a spin out on course, just as you were mentioning it, Rob, over in corner number two. No incident. It was Steve Burgess, and the yellow flag is flying. There is Burgess in that canary yellow and blue Justice Brothers sponsored number 12. Again, no wall contact, no contact with another car. 360 right in the center of the racetrack.
And a reprieve for Kenny Wallace in car number two, as he was within about four car lengths of losing a lap to Dick Trickle.
And many, many times, Rob, that's an excellent observation. Many times, that is the difference between winning and losing a race, when you get lucky like that early on.
Well, we saw a race a year and a half ago where Ted Musgrave allowed Gary St.Amant, after spinning, the opportunity to get going again without losing a lap, and Gary used it to his advantage. He won that race. So don't count Kenny Wallace out. Now he'll have a chance to put fresh tires on a car that he was not familiar with at all before he showed up this morning.
Someone else who was backsliding was Scott Hansen. I did not have an opportunity to see how much in jeopardy he was of going a lap down, but he comes out at the very tail of the pack, and all the leaders are going to duck in. The crew's going to take this opportunity to check particularly that tire wear.
In answer to your question, Hansen was right in front of Kenny Wallace, and this is a driver that, under green flag conditions, has not gone a lap down all year.
Down in the pits, Ralph.
Dick Trickle is taking his pit stop now, gentlemen. He is taking on right side tires and gas. That looks like it will be all, as the crew will come back around now to the left side of the car, and Dick Trickle will return.
Well, Bob Seneker beat him out of the pit area, and that's a function of just plain old week-to-week experience. This is the 10th consecutive weekend that these drivers have run events. They get a little bit of a respite, two-week break, before going to Syracuse, New York, Oswego, to be specific, on the 21st. But Seneker's crew all season long has gotten him in and out the quickest. They won a moneyed pit stop competition a week ago at Anderson Speedway.
Just about every driver will take an opportunity somewhere along the line during this caution flag to come in. We are under caution at the Minnesota State Fair. This is the American Speed Association.
Oh, man.
There's much civic pride in the Twin Cities. A local sportscaster, as we look at the top five, once said that people here were too nice to host professional athletics. Well, look what we got now. The Vikings once had purple people eaters and Timberwolves, and now the rough and ready American Speed Association, and there is the most ready of all of them, at least at this point, Bob Seneker.
It has just been amazing how, despite the fact that race after race will have qualifying times within three or four tenths of a second of one another, and all these young chargers coming up, that Bob Seneker and Mike Eddy continue to be at the top of the leaderboard. And there is Mike Eddy, who's now challenging Dick Trickle for position. We noticed just before going to break, Trickle is sliding backwards just a little bit. Glenn Allen Jr. just a few laps ago made him happen, quickly driven away from Dick Trickle.
And sixth position is what they're fighting for right now. Trickle, who led most of laps 1 through 100, has now slipped back, skipped back, if you will. He's still definitely in it. It's not like Dick Trickle is no longer a contender. The way things are going here today, you figure there's going to be at least one more yellow flag. There's Mike Eddy saying, hey, I don't like this pace right now that you're following. I got to move up because I see Allen and Pito and people like that just in front of you.
Now that orange car moving into the frame as well. Dave Jackson is running extremely well. I think this is the best performance we've seen from Jackson since his early race venture at Calgary Speedway out in Canada, where he finished a strong third and at the end of the race fastest car on the racetrack. Jackson has been in hot all afternoon and could be a threat here today. Look at him moving up on Dick Trickle. That car seems to work extremely well wherever he puts it. But a good handling race car this afternoon, and this is without question far more a handling racetrack. Chassis setup's more important than horsepower.
Dave Jackson, the man in orange, who wears the numbers that he wore back in high school. No, not as a race car driver, but as a halfback, both defensive and offensive, down in the Cincinnati, Ohio area. Dave Jackson, the man in the orange, number 45. And now I'm beginning to wonder whether or not Trickle burned something, burned it away in those first rapid 100 laps, as he really is backpedaling. Meanwhile, Ralph has been following the action as always down in the pits and bringing us an update.
Well, Larry, our buzzword for the day has been neutrality, and it's coming up once again. Remember how we said Dick Trickle was so neutral the car could go like crazy? Well, now it's gotten loose. The reason why it's gotten loose is those left side tires they put on didn't match up with the car the way the right side tires did when they changed those just before that last caution. So now Dick Trickle is battling a non-neutral race car. It's a little loose, and he's not as quick as he used to be.
On an oval track, that's usually a matter of stagger. What that refers to is the difference in the circumference of the outside tires and the inside tires. And I'm not a tireologist, but I'm thinking that the stagger on the inside must not have grown, because if he's loose, that means the car has a tendency to drive itself around the corners, and that the right sides are trying to push the car down into the infield.
Surprising, Dave Jackson from Ohio continues to work his way toward the front of the field, driving that Red Bank Trout Dapper Chevrolet around Mike Eddy. And in a move that we saw near the end of the race at Nashville, look at Eddy come right back on the bottom side. It forced Jackson, when he drove in really deep, he drifted up through the corner, but Dave has a quicker race car.
Dave Jackson turning in a terrific drive today. Now, we still got at least half of this race to go, so a long ways yet, but it does not figure that Eddy wants to be running the pace along with Trickle, as for that matter. Both of them would like to be closer to the front, so Jackson having a great day.
Bob Seneca is the leader in car number 84, and for the moment running all by himself. You could see Gary St.Amant is running right behind him. St.Amant a lot of laps down after experiencing frustrating problems.
Meanwhile, second place has now flared up again. Youth versus age, although on the experience spectrum, about the same in ASA.
Well, true in ASA, but Scott Hansen, a former four-time Fox River Racing Association champion, has probably 10 times the number of competitive laps under his belt than does Glenn Allen in car number 66.
And there goes Glenn Allen moving to the inside, so the 20-year-old driver moves into the runner-up spot. And Glenn Allen Sr. will now see if he can do anything with Bob Seneca, who has disappeared into the sunset. He's about a long 100-yard dash away. Make that a 440, as a matter of fact, as I look at the distance.
This has to make Glenn Allen Jr. and Papa Glenn Allen Sr., his crew chief, feel extremely good. They've also prepared the car that Kenny Wallace is driving here this afternoon. And I'm sure Daddy, even though there is no doubt he gave Kenny equal equipment, was just hoping that Junior would get the better of it this afternoon. And perhaps car owner Nick Vitt thinking the same thing. Kenny Wallace just running a couple of races this year, and Glenn Allen Jr. going for the points.
Glenn Allen Jr. began his ASA career in 1985. All of his race driving has been in a full-bodied stock car like this. His dad, Glenn Allen Sr., was a very strong contender at the Queen City or Tri-County Speedway, no matter which era you, or whatever era you grew up in. The track has changed its name. And of course, that's just north of the Cincinnati, Ohio area. They're Reds fans, but bigger motor racing fans.
Glenn Allen, a tremendous young athlete in his own right. He's not a big young man, about 5'8", probably 155, 160 pounds, but just solid as a rock. I remember those days. I remember them fondly.
But it continues to be Bob Seneker. There he is, the white and blue number 84. Kent Stauffer is in, and there's Ralph.
Kent Stauffer's having another tough day here. Larry, the crew's going to work, changing right side tires. You can see him also trying to straighten out the front air dam where he's bumped into a wheel here on pit lane. They're also trying to work on that right front tire, having a little trouble getting that on and off now. They'll get that completed as the tire finally comes off, and Kent Stauffer will come down off the jack and return to the action.
You can see where that bodywork is damaged in front. Sitting right behind that is the radiator. And that's why they were working so feverishly to pry that opening open. That car could get hot very quickly without air getting to the radiator.
Very unfortunate for Kent. He was having a good day. Looked like he had a top 10 car. Certainly a man with a top 10 car and maybe a winning car could be Bob Seneker. Approaching the halfway point, Seneker leads. Well, they race year-round here in the Minneapolis-St. Paul area. Year-round, you say? Yeah, the temperature will go down to minus 30 on occasion. But in the wintertime, they plow the snow off of the frozen lakes. There are about 30 in these Twin Cities. Carve out road courses and race cars. And right now, talking about races, we have a side-by-side battle for the number one position. Glenn Allen Jr. has rapidly closed in on Bob Seneker. A big surprise because Seneker had a very comfortable lead and they're just about side to side, door handle to door handle. Glenn Allen Jr. going for the number one position. Now Ralph is standing by in the pit area. Maybe he can keep us up to date on this battle. Second to second, he's standing next to Glenn Allen Sr.
That's right, and boy, your son is really doing a job out there, Glenn.
Yes, the Delco Voyager Chevrolet is running real good. We got jammed in the pits four or five times, couldn't get out. We had to work our way back around, but the car is working good now. We got the right setup now.
Is this the kind of setup that you can hold on to, or were you going to have to try and guess again later on as this track continues to change?
Well, we're waiting on the weather. It's getting hotter out, and the track's tightening up, so we're putting more stagger in the car. So car's working real good now, and we hope to have a good finish. We just keep it running.
Well, he's got the track figured out. Now he's just got to figure out how to get in and out of the pits, gentlemen.
Well, here are the drivers that remain on the lead lap now at this point in the race. Bob Seneker leads barely over Glenn Allen Jr. Scott Hansen is third. Tim Fedewa runs in fourth. Joe Shearer is fifth. Sixth is Dave Jackson. Mike Eddy is seventh, dropping to eighth position is Dick Trickle. Tony Raines ninth. Kenny Wallace is in 10th position in the 11th place car. And the last one we're showing on the lead lap, car number 81, Harold Fair.
Joe Shearer is turning in another good race. He started in 13th and he's moved up to the top five. There's a guy that I thought would have a better season, Rob, but I think it's a function of not able to run every one of the races. He can't keep that cutting edge. But here's a guy who truly could be a threat to win every race if he can just afford to get to all of them.
Joe's car owner, Fred Nielsen, fields several different types of stock cars for Joe. So they've got to kind of readjust every time they go to an ASA event from their former type of racing. Bob Seneker so far has been able to fend off the challenges of Glenn Allen Jr. As you can see them putting a lap on the slowing automobiles of Tim Steele and Ted Musgrave, who's really had problems all afternoon.
Musgrave darts into the pits as the lead continues to be up for grabs. It's a fast break up front, but who will score the next bucket this time around? Looks like it's going to be Seneker will be scored as the leader. They're barreling out of corner number four right now. Glenn Allen Jr., a patient Glenn Allen Jr. There were times, not that many years ago, where perhaps he would not have been that patient. Here's the Menin Skin Racer mid-race aftershave report. The leader is Bob Seneker. The average speed had dropped to a little bit below 75 miles per hour, about the average speed of the very first Indianapolis 500-mile race, incidentally. There have been five lead changes among four drivers. Three cautions, two of them very serious, as you can see, for 27 laps and five cars officially recorded as out of the race or behind the wall. After the mid-race point, the top five drivers were Seneker, who you're looking at on your screen right now, Glenn Allen Jr., Scott Hansen, Kim Fedewa, and Joe Shearer, who had come from deep in the back and qualified. 6 through 10, Dave Jackson, Mike Eddy, Dick Trickle, Tony Raines, and that's Kenny, not Rusty, Kenny Wallace.
You alluded to the Indy 500. We'd like to say hi to a recuperating friend of ours back in Indianapolis. Mark Dismore, a real racer's racer who was severely injured in a crash in practice for the Indianapolis 500. He's sitting at home. Lots of us know him. Lots of us sure admire his abilities behind the wheel of a race car. Mark, we're thinking about you. Get well quick, buddy.
Absolutely, Mark. When you're ready to go back to the zoo, that's the last time that my wife and I saw him, his wife and he, I'm ready.
I got to race go-karts against him a couple of times in my two years of go-kart racing, and he was just an unbelievable competitor then. We knew that given him the right opportunity, he could run in any type of racing car.
Another injury update, Tom Kendall is continuing to make progress, and kind of a nice little story about Tom Kendall and his brother, Bart. Part of the rehabilitation process is they're taking wheelchairs to their old high school and having races down the halls.
Remember Dave Jackson? We were talking about him a little bit ago as he got around both Dick Trickle and Mike Eddy. Well, it hasn't taken him very long to catch Tim Fedewa, and they're battling for fourth position. He'll now try to close up on Scott Hansen, who sits directly in front of him, and that first-place battle between Seneca and Glenn Allen Jr. Dave Jackson is just turning in a tremendous performance here today, and he's doing it much earlier in the race than we've seen him. Usually he waits till later in the race, and surprisingly, Dave prefers high bank racetracks. I talked to him before this race. You know, he was real mellowed out about his chances this afternoon.
Interestingly enough, though, this track may drive a little bit about a high bank, like a high bank racetrack. On a high bank racetrack, you're always on the edge of control. You're constantly fighting the car. You feel like you're a little bit over the edge. And what we've seen so far today here, Rob, this track drives like that. And it probably is a function of the fact there's so very little rubber laid down, meaningful racing rubber in the groove.
We're going to go back to the battle for the top position. Bob Seneca continues to be able to fend off Glenn Allen Jr. in car number 66. And what you can't yet see in your screen is that Scott Hansen is making up some time, and he has only a couple cars between him. So there you can see him creeping into the frame.
Oh,
and Dave Jackson's got problems.
Oh.
Dave Jackson has spun or has something amiss, and look at him, he's driving the car up near the wall in turn four.
That's corner number four, and we were just talking about Jackson and the terrific race he was having, and all of a sudden he comes to a stop.
It appeared, as he came to a stop there, that some liquid came out the right side of the car, and I don't see anything running down the very modest banking in turn number four. Dave has come to a complete halt in car number 45. And he does not appear to be frenetic in any way trying to get the machine under power. He may have lost the engine in car number 45. We'll just have to wait and see if something definitely arrived.
Dave is currently ranked ninth in points. His best finish so far of the 1991 season had been seventh. He has had some races where he has run hard. He is ninth in laps led and eighth in the number of laps that have been completed. Well, all the leaders are coming to a stop in the pit area. They're taking a chance to duck in. This is going to be a race of pit stops. Ralph Shaheen is with the Glenn Allen people.
And we've talked to you earlier about the trouble Glenn Allen has had getting in and out of the pit. He is in smooth. He's got Dennis Lampman in front of him. Glenn's tires are on the car now as they're getting set to drop him down off the jack. Let's see if he can get out. He does smoothly. Glenn Allen is out.
Bob Seneca also mentioned at the top. You see Mike Eddy coming out. Dick Trickle also had a pause during this pit stop, so no incidents in the pit area. 1991 has been the beginning for ASA. That's the first live television in its history, but it's also sadly an end. Sadly for some, there will be a new car that breaks across the horizon in 1992.
Stock car racing, in theory, is pitting vehicles off the showroom floor like this Chevy Lumina Z34 against one another. In 1992, ASA stock cars will take on a new look, one that is even more stock in appearance than ever before. In fact, if you take a template, one used by ASA officials in their pre-race tech inspection, and place it over the new car, and then place it over a new showroom stock car, it's a perfect fit. Now that's the outside of the car. What's new under the hood? Well, basically nothing. It's still purebred, high-tech ASA race car. A 9-to-1 compression ratioed V6 engine that is capable of burning unleaded fuel and uses a muffler. And another familiar ASA trademark, coilover shocks and rack and pinion steering. All of these items are similar to its showroom counterpart, but that's where the comparison ends. The engine in this race machine produces over 500 horsepower. And all that muscle goes to the ground through 10-inch Goodyear racing tires.
The new body style makes the 92 car 4 inches narrower and 2 inches higher. But will it race? Well, one driver who knows a little bit about ASA race cars took it out for a test drive a few weeks ago, and his reaction was a positive one.
It's a little narrower, a little higher. It's going to be a real competitive race car, and it'll make it a real even for everybody. We tested at Grand Rapids, Michigan, and it was 2 to 3 tenths slower right off of the trailer, which is not bad, and I believe with a little bit of work, it'll be just as fast as its counterparts.
What do these changes mean for race fans in 1992?
Well, this car is very close to its counterpart that rolls off the assembly line in Detroit. And I think this will provide the fan with car identification. Whether you're driving an Oldsmobile, a Buick, a Chevrolet, a Ford, or what have you, they can easily identify these cars, and I think that's going to be exciting for the fans.
The American Speed Association machines have always been the world's most technologically advanced stock cars. With this new design, the ASA is once again setting the standard.
Rob, there are two other reasons. This series has always striven to be a driver series. There's hoping that these cars will create a little more equality. Plus, they're very economic, hopefully making this series available to much more racers.
We've heard some exciting stories, Larry, about some drivers who've been very successful in other forms of racing, perhaps even a lot of open-wheel drivers, because of this new level playing field, considering coming racing with ASA. 92 is going to be dramatic indeed.
Well, we're back to green flag. That's Ted Muscle Man Musgrave up in that front position in the two-tone blue car, but Ted is not among the leaders of the race.
No, he isn't. Unfortunately, it's been already a long afternoon for Ted. To his credit, he's not running for points. You've just got to say, hey, thanks for coming and running here this afternoon and for staying in competition, even though technical problems or mechanical problems have put you several laps down. Great battle among four guys that we've talked about and talked about and talked about in our televised races. Seneca and Eddie up in front, and then those young Chargers, those young Lions, Glenn Allen Jr. and Scott Hansen, sitting right there, poised, ready to make the passes, should either one of those veterans slip in any way.
A theory. I felt that Glenn Allen Jr. was easily the fastest car on the track during the last green flag segment. I think he followed Seneca rather than try and test him this early in the race.
I think he did. Now, we'll see what happens as we go back to green flag racing. You can see that already Seneca and Eddie have moved away slightly from Glenn Allen Jr. and a little more difficulty getting past Ted Musgrave than did either of his predecessors. Other cars that remain on the lead lap behind fourth running Scott Hansen. Joe Shearer is still fifth. Tony Raines sixth. Dick Trickle is in seventh position in car number 99. Kenny Wallace hanging in on the lead lap in eighth spot. In ninth is still Tim Fedewa in car number 55. And Harold Fair is 10th in the 81 machine. 10 cars still on the lead lap.
Mark Lamoureux from Bloomington, Minnesota is the strongest, or has been to this point, of the local drivers who are competing here in one of those one-off races. Lamoureux was on the lead lap just a few laps ago. He was being shown unofficially in 12th position, so a call goes out to that driver. The best of the locals trying to pit himself against the traveling pros. No longer easy.
No, it sure isn't. And Lamoureux, again, one of those drivers that just handpicks a few races each year, and I'm sure it's a function of money more than anything else. If he had the bucks, he'd sure come running ASA on a full-time basis.
Well, Seneca now has established himself as the man, I guess, who has led the most often under different conditions in today's race. But certainly, this is easily a 5 or 6 car race. Don't forget about Dick Trickle. No, Dick Trickle hasn't fallen off the end of the earth. Dick Trickle's in a non-challenging sixth position, but well less than one half of a lap behind.
As we said earlier, these two drivers ran nose to tail last weekend, only in reverse order. Glenn Allen Jr. finishing fourth, Mike Eddie fifth, as Scott Hansen raced away to the win in the Anderson 400. Hansen has had a little more of an uphill struggle this afternoon, and Mike Eddie's car just seems to be maybe a beat or two shy of what he would like this afternoon. He's hanging tough in an H-wide Pontiac, but Glenn Allen Jr. in the Delco Voyager Chevrolet and Scott Hansen in the Delta Chevrolet are really there to heat him up.
Talk about someone whose point standings does not reflect his speed. Glenn Allen Jr. is currently ranked in 14th position. So we ask him, how is he approaching these last few races this season?
Well, we know we need to finish well for the points and start moving up and for the TV and everybody else, but we sure would like to win. We know we got a chance of winning. I think a lot of people think that, too, that's seen us race. We have a good shot. We just we have to do our P's and Q's right and everything, cross the T's, and I think everything will go well.
For a season that began with such promise, he won the opening race back in the frigid cold of April and May in Columbus, Ohio. Things have not gone downhill every race since then, but he's not been able to duplicate that feat in race number one.
Well, it's without doubt been the height of frustration for the entire racing team. You don't feel as bad about dropping back, as Scott Hansen now challenges Glenn Allen for that third position. You maybe not feel as bad about a season if you're not competitive as if you're a front runner. He's a front runner, and when you know that you've got the equipment, you know you've got the ability to run up in front, and yet little niggling things bother you all season long, it just drives you crazy.
Ralph has done an excellent job of keeping us up to date this afternoon about the factor of tires. And if you're wondering why Glenn Allen Jr., for instance, does not appear to be as quick this time as he was the last green flag segment, why has Hansen been good sometimes and not good another green flag segment? We've seen Trickle come in and out of the leading picture. It's tires. This track is very tricky. All tracks are tricky on tires, but this one just a little more so. And one of the big factors in the finish of this race will be, will everybody be able to stop at the same time for the final pit stop, and who will get the best set of matched four tires?
And when will that pit stop come? When will that caution period come? And how long do you wait running the risk of coming in and getting the freshest rubber late? And that's, you know, we'll be answering those questions probably the next 50 to 75 laps. Scott Hansen is really giving Mike Eddy some pressure.
All of the yellow flags, the most recent set of them, came about lap 150. So you would think that about the 250 lap point, everybody will have to come in again. The yellow flag would certainly make it convenient. You mentioned Hansen. Boy, Hansen is as good as we have seen him all day. He now moves into second place.
And Mike gives it up grudgingly. Let's see if Hansen is able to close the margin that Bob Seneker has been able to build. It's about, 2 to 2.5 seconds, or about a third of a straightaway that Hansen must now make up.
The 1.5 mile racetrack. It's not as circular in form as Langhorne once was. There's the distance between first, second, third, fourth. Corners are long here. Each of them is probably about 600 feet long, straightaway 700 feet each. So you can really keep the RPMs up. Very abrasive to the equipment, particularly the tires. And what is up for grabs right now is first place. There is Scott Hansen pressuring Bob Seneker. He was side by side coming down the front straightaway the last lap. He had to move over for John Olson as the duo was putting one lap on Mr. Olson. But Scott Hansen has shown us to be the speed demon of ASA in the past 40 laps. Now, Glenn Allen Jr. runs third, Mike Eddy is fourth, and Dick Strickland has moved up to fifth, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 appear to be tightening up.
And a sixth car has moved into it as well. Car number 25, Tony Raines, is right behind Dick Strickland's number 99. This is going to be a good one before it's over with. Look at Hansen moving to the low side. This third-year ASA driver giving the veteran Bob Seneker fits as they go down into turn number one. Hansen has the advantage. Seneker pushes him right down below the white line, the flat part of the racetrack, and maintains the position.
About two-thirds of this race is now over, over 100 laps to go. And we hear from Ralph during the last break that this has all been chess playing up till now during this last green flag segment. If it does not go yellow again, everybody thinks they can go the distance. Oh, what an unusual complexion that would put to this race.
It certainly go the distance on fuel. These cars are capable of getting about 100 miles or 200 laps on this racetrack from a tank of fuel. And tires have been the question all afternoon. And like you say, it's a master game of strategy.
And if we do go the distance, I look back to Glenn Allen Jr. and to Dick Trickle. Those are the two guys, in my opinion, who have treated their tires the most politely.
Without doubt, those are the two drivers that have shown the most patience and restraint on the racetrack. They're the ones who, as the green flag period unfolds, seem to get stronger and stronger. Seneker has come back now to those top five automobiles stacked up behind him.
Well, there have been many, many races, and I've watched Bob Seneker, though, and two other guys have had the fastest cars, and somebody else is handling better. The Seneker's limping, and he wins.
It can happen.
He is amazing. Bob Seneker, you're looking at him right now as a leader in points for the 1991 season. There is probably no one on the track who is better at driving a used-up race car than Seneca. A lot of guys, you know, maybe are faster than Bob. And certainly people are better qualifiers. And there are people that have a lot of their future ahead of them. Bob is right now living the summit of his career. But when it comes to driving on a car that's really used up, Bob Seneca is very good.
Well, he is now getting every ounce of ability that he has or has ever possessed tested. As Scott Hansen is really, really working hard on him now as he's closed right in behind Carter Brady, who almost had made the pass at one point, and Seneca was able to use Dennis Vogel's lap, car number 51, for a block and managed to maintain that position. He's let Hansen get a fender alongside and then just gently, gingerly forced Scott to the lowest part of the racetrack, and that heats up the right side tires and it slows Hansen down. He'll have to try to mount now another challenge.
Seneca has looked like that proficient NFL running back the last couple of laps, maybe a fullback who doesn't have the speed of the guy that is chasing him, but he's used others as blockers. Tenth place is now Steve Burgess, and he has been put one lap down by the race leaders. The pace, although not quite as quick as laps 1 through 100, is still very torrid. At the Minnesota State Fair today, we're live. This is the American Speed Association. This is the fifth time we've had one of these races on the Nashville Network this season, and they have been very excellent races. We hope that you enjoy at home and enjoyed them also.
And even though this is our last telecast, race fans, make sure you stay tuned to TNN and Motorsports Magazine on Sunday afternoon, as we will continue to give you the progress counting down for the 1991 AC Delco Challenge Series Points Championship.
Another opportunity to update yourself on your favorite car, driver, or team. John Olson going by there. Up in the right-hand corner, the lap time on the race leader, Bob Seneca. Qualifying lap time was 19.7 and change, a little bit under 100 miles per hour. You can see that Seneca is going about 3 seconds slower than he qualified. A little slower pace, frankly, than what I would have expected. And as we mentioned, first through five appear to be tightening up. This could be a shootout to the very end in Minnesota. These Twin Cities started life back in the early 1800s as a fort overlooking the confluence of the Minnesota and the Mississippi rivers. The fort was supposedly to protect the settlers from the Indians, or maybe it was the other way around. Seneca would like to have such a fort right now. He's really getting attacked.
Well, I thought that Gary Clem and Ken Dennis were our producer and director, but Bob Seneca is trying to maintain his own production out on the racetrack and tell these other guys where he wants them when car number 53, Scott Hansen, tries to make the pass. This is while we were at break. Hansen tried to get around Seneca, got him a little bit sideways, but did you see Hansen backed off the throttle,
yeah,
let Seneca get it straightened out, said, okay, I'll get another shot.
It's one of them AT&T passes.
Yes.
Reach out and touch them. Although he didn't make it. He failed in his effort, but Scott Hansen, as you pointed out, very gently moved. He wouldn't have been so nice, I don't think, had this been lap number 297, but for now, it's a nice call.
Well, again, Hansen still in a battle for the points. He'd like to win the race and the national championship. 6/10 of a second, the margin between first and second positions on the racetrack. You can see, it's very vivid, very graphically, when these two guys go through the corners, Seneca's is at a little more of an angle than Hansen. Scott's car is simply working better than Bob's, with Bob calling on all that experience to maintain that lead.
Seneca also was the cutting edge. Sure, the interval shrinks to 0.2 seconds. He was the cutting edge as the two of them sliced through traffic, and they got through much more efficiently than the third running Glenn Allen Jr. and fourth running Mike Eddy. They are clear of traffic. They've got all green ahead of them, whereas Allen and Eddy are still in traffic.
Don't you have to think, Larry, at this point in time, that Scott Hansen knows he's got a better handling race car? If we have caution, they're probably both going to come in for tires. If we go green, there's still enough laps left that Hansen will get a number of new shots at the win.
Yeah, I definitely think so. And as he sees Bob Seneca really working to try and hold on, he figures, if I work my car to death, I'm going to be in the same position. If I hold back just a little bit now, don't punish those tires, I should have more race car for the final 50 laps.
Scott, of course, was the 1989 ASA Rookie of the Year and the first rookie in ASA history to win an event, that coming on the Milwaukee Mile. And then last year, backed it up with a third-place national championship points finish.
There have been five lead changes among four drivers. Here's a young man who has not led, I don't believe, yet this afternoon, but he's been close enough on a number of occasions to record one of those leading laps.
He's in third, about a half straightaway behind both Seneca and Hansen.
Seneca, as you saw just a couple moments ago, has led 101 laps, more than anyone else. But that lead is precarious. There he is, back again, using lap cars. This time, Steve Burgess, who was running close to the top 10 just a few laps ago, has a pick. Bob Seneca fighting to hold on to first place, and Scott Hansen, we believe, content to let him keep that fight up on his own. Eddie is fourth, Trickle is fifth, Tim Vitawa, that four, is in sixth position. Tony Raines, his characteristic top 10, he is in seventh. Kenny Wallace in the Allen prepared machine, the Glenn Allen Senior and Junior prepared machine, is eighth. Burgess, who you just saw the lap, he's at the yellow and the blue car right there, one lap down in ninth position. And Harold Fair, another driver who had a drive shaft problem in qualifying and practice this morning. They lost the rear end. Hasty repairs, they came out and qualified. He is in 10th position, but now two laps back.
A brief respite for Bob Seneca, who's opened about a 10-car length gap over Hansen. Four right now, at least. And I think Scott may be just kind of sitting back waiting for his opportunity. Ralph, I think, is down in the pits with Scott Hansen's crew chief, Howie Lennon.
Howie, are you comfortable running in second and just biding your time?
Well, I think we'd like to be leading, but right now, second place is a whole lot better than where we were about 50 laps into this thing.
How is this car handling, and is he going to have enough to go if it stays green?
The car is just a little bit loose. We got one more adjustment we want to make if we get a yellow, and go from there. Other than that, we'll be all right. I don't know if we'll be able to take Bob or not if it stays green, but we're running pretty good.
Well, you heard Howie say that his car was loose. It's interesting to note as well, gentlemen, that Dave Taylor, crew chief for Bob Seneca, mentioned that Bob's car is loose also.
Scott Hansen won the Nationwide 400 at Salem Speedway, the second race of the season, and then won last weekend on ASA's shortest racetrack, the quarter-mile high bank facility at Anderson, Indiana. Two victories and only the third driver this season to have multiple wins.
Seeing how you mentioned Anderson and Dick Trickle's in this race, my all-time favorite description of a racetrack. Hey, Dick Trickle, what's it like running ASA cars at Anderson? Reply, like jet fighters in a gymnasium.
And folks, that is no exaggeration. A little facility that literally is in the backyard of the home offices of Anderson is Pendleton, Indiana, which is the home offices of the American Speed Association. They pack that place for our ASA race there.
Speaking about packed crowd, we've had a great house this afternoon at the Minnesota State Fair. The Beach Boys performed in concert right on this front straightaway yesterday afternoon and yesterday evening. They had a packed house, and we have another one this afternoon. Labor Day 1991 in the USA.
Well, the inexperience and the experience right there on your screen. Tim Vitawa, who's been strong all afternoon, has caught Dick Trickle. Trickle occupies the fifth position. Vitawa wants it in car number 55. And that's just the way he did it last weekend at Anderson, running on the high side of the racetrack. And he and the Earl Gurdy folks that build the engines and Ray and Diane DeWitt that field these cars really have got this V6 Ford figured out, as he is just getting stronger and stronger as the season progresses.
I don't think without a doubt the last 2 weeks have been the strongest this car has shown. He was a threat to win a week ago. I don't think he has a winning mount this week, but that's definitely top five material.
Well, that goes without saying. And there's still, you can't count anybody that remains on the lead lap out of it for the win this afternoon. We've got about 75 laps to go. I'm sure that everybody who's on the racetrack has their fingers crossed praying for just one more caution to get new right sides. Vitawa picks up fifth position.
You can see Vitawa now in fifth. His best finish so far this season, despite all those speeds, has been an eighth. He has led 48 laps. He's run all 14 of the races on the ASA schedule and ranked 13th in the overall point standings. But having a better race than Harold Fair, whom he is only 10 points behind, and a much better race than Kent Stauffer, who is also within striking distance of.
Meanwhile, up front, Bob Seneca's really opened up the margin over Scott Hansen. Any explanation, Larry?
Boy.
Care to guess?
None whatsoever, unless crew chief down there in the pits was telling Ralph the truth that they were giving it all they had. He was not waiting. He was not biding his time. And that was the best shot. That was the best cannon that Scott Hansen had when he got right alongside of Seneca. When that failed, he had nothing left. And now they're hoping and praying for a yellow flag.
And we've got a great battle now forming for fourth position. Tim Feedaway, he's got to be really feeling his oats right now. He's just passed the guy that's won 1,000 features, and now he's going by maybe ASA's only five-time national champion, and he'll try again on the high side of the racetrack.
Tim Feedaway, not only with a lot of horsepower, but a perfectly handling car, apparently. Now, I have seen him slide a couple of times that may be abusing the tires, but it doesn't seem to set him back significantly. He comes right back the next corner and moves in. Feedaway, very rapid.
You'd like Tim if you ever met him. He is very personable, mid-20s, confident without being cocky, and that's kind of a fine line there. He knows he's got some ability, and he says he's got the team and the car owner that eventually could take him to the top in ASA.
Well, we've all been speculating about Scott Hansen. He was challenging. Was he giving it all he had? Was he waiting? Now he seems to be slipping back. You can see Seneca is caught in heavy traffic. Now, this gives Hansen an opportunity to move in, but he has not been able to do it on his own. That's Seneca trying to work his way around Wallace. John Wilson to the high side. Here comes Hansen. He gets his first close-up look at Bob Seneca in about the last 10 laps. But Ralph, he was slipping by when they had, or slipping behind when they had a clear track. Any idea why?
Well, we talked to Howie Leto again, Larry, and as you watch Scott Hansen go around the racetrack, you can see the car still isn't handling right, and as soon as Seneca gets a clear racetrack, he pulls away. Scott Hansen did use up the majority of that car trying to get around him, and Howie confirmed it. Boy, we need a pit stop now. We don't have a whole lot left like we thought we might have.
Well, Bob Seneca's got a very difficult task right in front of him. Kenny Wallace is the last car on the lead lap, running in ninth position, and he will not roll over and play dead for Seneca. He certainly learned some lessons in his last several years of competition. He was an ASA Rookie of the Year in 1986, got a lot of laps under his belt, and he's certainly going to give it everything he's got to keep Seneca in his rearview mirror.
Kenny Wallace has a couple of career ASA poles, but no victories. Bob Seneca, of course, the leading winner of all time, 70 wins. And incidentally, Scott Hansen in the car number 53, running in second position, has only won five times in ASA competition, but as we have reported many times, he's relatively new to this type of late model professional racing.
He's won five before today, and this just may be the sixth feather in his ASA racing cap. Kenny Wallace slid coming off turn number two. Bob Seneca used it to his advantage and puts young Wallace a lap in arrears.
225 laps are now in the books. 75 to go. And here comes Feedaway again. Two abreast formation, like the start of the race.
Feedaway is now losing a position that he just took away from Dick Trickle a few laps ago. We watched him working the high side of Mike Eddy's car number 88. I think he probably superheated right sides. It caused him to slow down, and now he is falling just a bit. Now he's got to contend with Trickle once again.
That Kenny Wallace that we saw just lose a lap about two laps ago, recall, he started in 23rd position. So, unbalanced, they've had a pretty solid day, never challenged for the lead, but is running 8th from the 23rd starting slot.
And not probably many of our viewers have ever had an opportunity to sit behind the wheel of the race car. We've talked repeatedly this afternoon about the abrasiveness of the racetrack and the pressure on the right side tires. Well, you know when you go around a corner that's flat, it wants to throw you out the right side of your car. If you go through a corner, even on an entry ramp to an interstate that's slightly banked, you know that feeling of settling down in your seat, pressing you down. And that's what these drivers are going, having to deal with. And that's especially what the tires are having to take up the force, the centrifugal force of the cars going very hard into this relatively flat racetrack.
The Minnesota State Fair has a grand tradition. It was this racetrack when it was dirt that first introduced America to the names of Parnelli Jones and Jim Herdebees. Running the IMCA sprint cars, they first reached fame here. Today, the famous are the American Speed Association drivers. We'll be back. We are under yellow at the Minnesota State Fair for the fifth time this afternoon. This is for a minor incident caused when Steve Burgess lost control in corner number two, spun around. There is Steve. in the canary yellow, in Petty Blue, number 12, car sponsored by the Justice Brothers. The yellow flag has come out. All the leaders will dive into the pits, and Ralph Shaheen is standing by between Bob Seneca and Scott Hansen Pitts.
This is exactly what everybody needed. Is Scott Hansen, or let's make that Bob Seneca, brings number 84 to a stop. The crew goes to work on the right side. They're putting tires on his car. Mike Eddy getting tires as well on the right side. Scott Hansen getting tires on the right side as well. Here comes Seneca. He's exiting out of the pits. Here comes Hansen right behind him, and there will not be a single car in between the two of them. Should be a great shootout, gentlemen.
And a near collision on pit road. Tim Fedewa in car number 55, a tremendous pit stop, almost ran right over the right front fender of Glenn Allen Jr.'s car number 66. Both of them made it out unscathed, but great stops for both of those young drivers.
Fedewa, tremendous stop. Now, Mike Eddy is still in the pit. Ralph.
They had a problem getting the right rear tire off the car, Larry. They finally got it off. They finally got the new one on, and now Mike will come out and he will just beat out the pace car.
Oh, that was very close. There goes Eddy, and the pace car is not more than 50 feet from him as he exits pit road. We're still under yellow, so this will set Mike back in terms of track space. But boy, that was a near disaster for Mike Eddy in his efforts to win here this afternoon.
We hate to put too much emphasis on a single pit stop, but I think the outcome of the race very well could have been determined right there by the speed of the pit stops.
Well, this is the Minnesota State Fair, and there are, of course, a lot of things you can do. Eat elephant ears, go to the races, or you can go to the races, like a few people that we saw yesterday were. Now, I feel only fair to point out that the guy on the left gets rear-ended. Now see Jeff Neilhall on Farias. See there on the right-hand side of the screen? He's got a wheel into me, and I'm sliding across first, but I'm upside down.
Look at Shaheen. Ralph, I'll tell you what. Glenn Allen Jr. is a football player, but Shaheen wrestled him to the bottom, didn't he?
Well, there's more to do than just slides at the fair. Of course, there are the bumper cars.
Larry, you don't look like you're having enough fun there. You look too formal, too intense.
Scott Hansen.
Oh!
Getting rear-ended or side-ended, whatever it is. Jeff Neal in the white shirt. But then the crowning achievement of the day was this race, which was won, of course, by a broadcaster, not a race driver. Ralph Shaheen, the victor of the skee-ball car race at the Minnesota State Fair.
Rumors had it, though, that might not have been won fairly. Ralph, what do you think, huh?
Well, I think you're just a sore loser there, Mr. Albright. First of all, I was trying to keep Gary St.Amant from cheating.
Oh, yeah,
I think the instant replay will show that Mr. St.Amant was reaching up in there trying to drop the ball.
Oh, we've got an instant replay. Maybe not.
Now, here was the result of the pit scramble during this most recent yellow flag. Seneca and Hansen in first, out second. Both of them held their own. Glenn Allen Jr. lost out, but the big gainer was Tim Fedewa. And look at Mike Eddy. He went in fourth with that nasty right rear tire. He comes out in seventh position, and he is almost a quarter of a lap behind the race leaders.
Apparently a malfunctioning air gun for Mike Eddy's pit crew has cost him a shot at the race this afternoon. And maybe before the season is over, this could be a turning point in the national championship quest. Mike Eddy going after sixth. Bob Seneca leading the points, trying to make it two in succession.
Seneca and Eddy were separated by only 40 points going into this race this afternoon. 2,356 points for Bob Seneca and 2,320 for Mike Eddy. Eddy has won six times, Seneca four. You can see Bob Seneca has been the more consistent.
All of the cars on the lead lap, with the exception of Tony Raines' car number 25, took on fresh right side tires. Tony put left sides on car number 25. He sits in fifth position behind this pair that we're looking at up front, as well as Tim Fedewa and Glenn Allen.
Scott Hansen appears to have it back. Scott Hansen moves to the inside of Seneca. They touch ever so slightly in corner number four. This time Hansen figures not to be so polite. Let's see how they play it. They come into corner number two. This is right where Eddy and Seneca came together a year ago, and Hansen moves under.
Not to be denied, Scott Hansen has wrestled literally the lead, the top position away from Bob Seneca, and will try now to hang on to make it two in a row here this weekend at Minnesota. And Glenn Allen Jr. has gotten by Tim Fedewa. He's taken over the third position. There you see him coming into your screen. He'll now try to catch Seneca and Scott Hansen. It ain't over yet.
And Seneca is quickly slipping further behind Scott Hansen. Bob Seneca does not have the race car underneath him, at least at this lap point. That Scott Hansen does.
Look at the cars right together, and Mike Eddy at the tail end of that group of cars running on the lead lap. No doubt he's furious right now in car number 85. He's close right in behind Tony Raines, and he's still got a shot at a top four or five finish, maybe even higher than that before it's over.
Here is what the bump looked like a little earlier. There is Scott Hansen going to the inside in corner number four. They come together. No harm, no foul on that particular one. Hansen was able to keep up the momentum, and he would not be denied. We have a spin in corner number two. A spin in corner number two as you continue to look at that replay of the pass. That is Gary St.Amant. He was not involved with any other driver. We'll come back and show you that replay one more time, but live action on the track sort of intervened on that replay. But that is, again, Gary St.Amant. Oh, it's been another long afternoon with a young man from Ohio State Buckeye country.
I think he was running in third or fourth position when he had some mechanical problems, spent 34 laps behind the wall, and since coming on the racetrack, he's been among the fastest cars out there, but a whole bunch of laps off the pace.
He doesn't look too overjoyed about the thing.
No, he doesn't. Rarely do you see him without a smile.
All right, let's go back again and look at that replay of the pass.
And you can see Scott Hansen just sticking that nose in there, slides down below the white line, really taking advantage of every possible inch, or maybe he didn't have much option. That's where he had to go, almost in the grass as he took over the point.
All the leaders will come in this time, probably changing left side rubber. Ralph Shaheen will give the call.
Well, the first one down here will be Scott Hansen. He dives in. Bob Seneca right behind him. Mike Eddy will jump in between the two of them. Left side tires going on all the top competitors. Who will get in and out of here first will be a big deciding factor as to who has the best track position. Here it goes, Hansen. He's down off the jack. Seneca goes as well. Seneca's got him beat. Oh, they almost touched, leaving the pit lane.
Well, as they come back out on the racetrack, Ralph, the cagiest theory of the punch just made me think Trickle stayed on the track and did not come on pit road.
A couple of things. They were side by side, Hansen and Seneca, when they left the pits. Now, somebody with ASA has got to make a call, because I don't think, honestly, either one of those drivers knows which one should be lined up in front of the other one. They were side by side when they exited the pits. Glenn Allen Jr. is right behind him, but again, as Rob pointed out, Dick Trickle chose not to pit. Now, there is the conversation about who belongs in front of the other one, Seneca or him. Well, we were trying to pick up on that conversation. We could not, but it does appear as though the decision has been made, and they have given it to Bob Seneca, and things happened so quickly. I didn't see if Seneca was on the inside or Hansen on the outside, but I think that may have been the determining factor that Bob was on the inside of the exit.
Perhaps it could have been. That was a very animated young crew chief, Dave Taylor, for Bob Seneca, lobbying his case, and apparently it worked.
Well, has Dick Trickle outfoxed all of the ASA veterans? We'll find out when we come back to the Minnesota State Fair. Live from the Minnesota State Fair, this is the American Speed Association, the AC Delco Challenge. Now, here's the pit exit. There is Scott Hansen pulling out, running past the stop sign, incidentally. There is Bob Seneca on the inside. Hansen appears to have a fender ahead, but Seneca is on the inside. But the biggest story of all was who did not stop, and he finds himself with a half-lap lead over other top contenders. We have, what, 270 laps?
260, just 260 over 260. And we're still showing seven cars on the lead lap. Dick Trickle all by himself out in front. And Tim Fedewa was having problems down in turn number four, slipped up out of the groove, now gets it going once again. Trickle is the leader all by himself on the racetrack in second position, battling through traffic. Scott Hansen, Bob Seneca runs third, fourth is Glenn Allen, fifth is now Mike Eddy. In sixth position is Tony Raines, and Tim Fedewa was off the pace down the backstretch in car number 55. Something's definitely awry in that automobile.
There is Tim Fedewa, who had run as high as third, and following this round of final pit stops, had he been able to keep the same velocity as he had before them, he would have been one of the challengers for the lead in this race.
No smoke, which is an indication that probably a tire has gone flat on Fedewa's car number 55, may have run up over some debris when he slipped up out of the racing group.
Boy, can you believe it? What bad luck.
Major disappointment this near the end of the race, with a shot at a top third or fourth place finish.
Dick Triple, who chose not to stop, he is basically riding a powder keg. It has been lit. His tires are not as good as the people who stopped during that last caution flag. And the question becomes, does he have enough laps to protect himself? Does he have enough insulation to protect himself from the four people who were running up front, challenging for the lead, who chose to stop? They were Scott Hansen, that white and red trim number 53, Bob Seneker, Glenn Allen Jr., and Mike Eddy.
Well, I think the decision perhaps on how these two drivers restarted this race based on where they were when they went by the man that controls the stop and go board at the end of pit road. And Hansen seemed to have a slight edge when he got there, and he'll maintain that position, at least for the time being, in car number 53. And Seneker's right there with him. He's not losing any ground, but he's not really showing any challenge as we've reached lap 270. Now 30 laps to go for Dick Trickle.
A subtle change in the top five. Mike Eddy has moved underneath of Glenn Allen Jr. Allen Jr. appears to be a little off the pace, although still running at full song. There is Mike Eddy. You can see he's gotten around Allen. Eddy begins to pull away and move in to challenge Bob Seneker. Now, that's an important move. Mike Eddy is currently second in points, almost 40 points behind Bob Seneker. Seneker is third in this race, and he sees him now over the hood, and Mike Eddy would like at least to get around Bob Seneker.
Mike Eddy, without a doubt, the biggest beneficiary of this most recent caution, the one immediately prior to that. You'll remember the air gun jammed on that crew, and he is forced to the back of the pack. And now you can see the margins separating second and third. There's fourth place, car number 88 of Mike Eddy, and right behind him now is the green and white car number 66 of Glenn Allen.
And a big problem, lap traffic of Jeff Neal and Kenny Wallace side by side. There is nowhere for the leaders to go, and right now Dick Trickle is gaining a bigger advantage than he had a couple of laps ago. These two guys may be helping him win the race. Oh, tight quarters going into corner number three. Seneker has to slam the door on Mike Eddy. He slides into corner number three. And once again, Wallace and Neal go side by side.
Well, neither Kenny Wallace nor Jeff Neal really should be out there racing with these leaders. They're both at least one lap off the pace, and therefore should not really come into play in the settling of the argument that's going on right behind them. And look who's crept up right in behind as well. Glenn Allen Jr. that time took a look at the outside of Mike Eddy as they went down the back stretching into turn three.
I gotta believe at one time Kenny Wallace was a comrade in arms, but there gotta be a couple of leaders. Seneker and Eddy and Allen, three of them, are not too happy right now with Kenny Wallace.
There it is, that battle for third and fourth positions and a battle for the top position in the point standings between Bob Seneker and Mike Eddy.
Inside now of 25 laps to go. Here comes Mike Eddy. Here is the challenge we're expecting. Mike Eddy looking toward the points lead. He won't get out of here with a points lead by beating Bob Seneker by one position, but it's three or four more points closer he would get on the season-long point standings.
Exactly 1 year ago today, these two drivers on this very racetrack.
Right in that corner, right there.
And traded paint, and eventually Seneker went sailing around, and that piece of footage probably has been shown more this season than any single 5 seconds of the 1990 ASA racing season. They just as soon get it behind them and forget it. It's awfully hard to forget it when things are so tight in the course of 1991.
Well, you see it in circuit after circuit after circuit. Everybody tries to patch their differences, and through the early part and out to the mid part of the season, they're all bosom buddies, both on and off the track. But the pressure of the points championship always seems to bubble to the top, and tempers get flared.
Well, that's Scott Hansen just now you saw going out of the picture. He's in second place. You saw Trickle just a second or two before that.
So does Dick Trickle have enough time? Does Scott Hansen have enough time? Perhaps when we come back, we'll find out the answer to these and others. Minnesota State's Fair, we would like to remind you that this telecast is a copyrighted production of Group 5 Sports, a division of Group 5 Sales Incorporated. Any use, rebroadcast, or other transmission of this telecast without the written consent of Group 5 Sports is prohibited. You're looking at Jay Sauter. Jay Sauter from West Salem, Wisconsin, the son of Jim Sauter, the prolific father, if you will, of motor racers. Jay has had a tough day. He was involved in a lap one crash among the top 10 qualifiers again this afternoon, but apparently his day has ended. About 20 laps in the end here.
Well, don't consider this one over yet. We've got about 14 laps to go. Dick Trickle still leads this race. The car number 99, there you can see 15 laps remaining in the race this afternoon. And Scott Hansen is reeling him in. The margin has gone from 2.4 to 2.1 to 1.8, at least on my stopwatch. I hope I'm not jumping the gun to the advantage of Scott Hansen, but he is definitely closing in on Trickle. Now, if he catches him, can he get around? That's a much larger question.
1.8 divided by 0.3, which is his rise each lap. That's six laps. There's 15 to go. Beginning to look like that Scott Hansen is going to have enough time. Scott Hansen is the only driver other than Mike Eddy and Bob Seneker to win more than one race this year. At the top of the show, we told you that it seemed as though that Scott Hansen is on a roll. Now, Rob, what was it down to that lap? Half a second difference.
Scott Hansen in car number 53. Howie Letow is pleased with the way the car's running. He's certainly, you know, moving up on Trickle, but he's just out of laps unless we have a caution. And Gary St.Amant slowing again on the back straightaway in car number 7. If Hansen sees him, he's got to be praying, please, Gary, stop. Don't make it to pit road, but he will, and he'll not bring out a caution flag.
Scott Hansen has won two races in the 1991 season. Mike Eddy has won six times. Bob Seneca four. The other victory that's not accounted for on the trail was turned in by Darrell Waltrip on the first of these live telecasts from Nashville, Tennessee. This is the final live telecast of the heartland of America on this AC Delco Challenge. We visited Kansas City, Nashville, Pittsburgh, and today we're in the Twin Cities of Minneapolis, St. Paul, and we will be back in the 1992 season. There will be at least 10 races on the television schedule next season, and watch for more. And as we commented earlier, also the Nashville Network will be following this series to its conclusion in 1991, so watch for periodic updates.
Some exciting new venues too next year as well. It's going to be really tremendous. Here's the gap now, 1.2 seconds between Trickle and Hansen.
Stabilized that time around because he was at 1.3. Hansen had to go high to get a lap on Tom Harrington. That slowed him down. Boy, Hansen was just wishing that this was a 305 lap race.
Well, he knows. They all know. They've been outfoxed by the foxiest of the bunch. And Dick Trickle's just trying to steal that big bunch of grace. He may have it. Big bonus, too, if he wins the race after having qualified for the pole position.
And don't you believe that Dick Trickle is well aware of that? Well, the man who has won more races than any other active driver in the United States of America in his career may be going after yet another checkered flag this afternoon. Dick Trickle from traditionally Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin. He lives down in North Carolina, of course, right now, trying to also maintain his Winston Cup and Busch Grand National career. This is the Jim Gruen Trickle Motorsports Chevrolet. And now slower traffic could be the next hurdle that Dick Trickle has to scale.
Dick Trickle came here last year as a southern visitor to the Great North. He's in a decent position. There's Mike Eddy. Mike Eddy has fallen off of Bob Seneca's back bumper. He's running in the fourth position. And back up front, there's the margin between first and second positions between Dick Trickle and Scott Hansen, and it has apparently stabilized.
I don't think he has enough time, Rob. Hansen does still appear to be just a little quicker. It's funny that the time has stabilized, but the distance has shrunk just a little bit, at least the visual distance. But I don't think he has enough time. Unless lap traffic plays a role here and reels Dick Trickle back toward Scott Hansen, it's getting very late.
Well, that may happen. That time by leader Dick Trickle completed lap number 397, and three remain with Tim Steele and Mark Lamoureux directly in front of him on the racetrack. And I'm sure that Trickle hasn't run exceptionally hard either. He's been in communication with his crew chief by radio. He's got a rearview mirror, and he's probably just running the car as easily as he can, saving it just in case Hansen gets right there at the finish.
Lap 298. two laps separate 1 mile, separates Dick Trickle from win number 30 of his ASA career. We will anticipate the white flag this time around. We're riding with Tim Steele. You'll see the white flag right inside of your screen. There it is, as it's given to Dick Trickle, and there just is not enough time. There are only 4 or 5 car lengths separating him from Scott Hansen, but less than a quarter of a mile to go now.
Scott Hansen has really driven that car hard over the last 30 laps after that caution. He had to know it was too late. He committed to the pit stop, and now Trickle just steals the win this afternoon.
A very popular victory for Dick Trickle. This is Dick Trickle country. Dick Trickle, as well as Scott Hansen, the locals have to be very happy as they see a man who has won over 1,000 times in his racing career, and most of those 1,000 wins have been with a 250-mile radius of this city. They see him come home the victor today in the American Speed Association 300 at the Minnesota State Fair. Listen to the crowd. A very popular win. This was as big a win for Trickle on ASA as Nashville was for Darrell Walker.
Dick Trickle, 2 previous victories here at Minnesota State Fair, 1982, and then most recently in 1987, beating Ted Musgrave to the checkered flag. Thousands of fans now, Dick Trickle fans, most of them, I'm sure, will throng down trackside, hopefully to get an autograph and a word with their favorite race driver. And he's, you know, not all that ecstatic, at least not yet. He's got a slight grin creasing his face. And many, many times he's found himself waiting for that winner's interview.
Well, Dick Trickle has had a long weekend. He has competed, as we mentioned earlier this afternoon, at Darlington. Ran very strong in the Busch Grand National race on Saturday. Made the drive, or the flight, rather, overnight here to the Twin City areas of Minneapolis, St. Paul. And before the race even began, he said, you know, if I do well here today, or if I win this race, I'm dedicating this to my crew, because I certainly could not have done it without them. They prepared the car. I showed up, and I made some tweaks and went racing.
One of the top 3 finishers, car number 99, Dick Trickle, of course, the winner, Scott Hansen, finishing 2nd in the Baker Delta machine, and Bob Seneca, or Scott Hansen, and then Bob Seneca in the Lane Automotive Port City Chevrolet, finishing in 3rd position.
It is somewhat of a victory in the point standings for Seneca, because he finishes ahead of the man in 2nd place, but in point of fact, it stabilizes the points, because Eddie slips a little bit behind, but Scott Hansen slips a little bit ahead. Well, the man who was ahead mostly today, and mostly when it counted, is right now with Ralph Shaheen.
Well, we got Dick Trickle down here, and you're looking at your shoes. Something wrong with your shoes?
I don't know, but I think when I walked across the track, I got some tar off the track on the bottom of my driving shoe, and my foot was sticking to the pedals all day, and it was kind of annoying, but, you know, I got to give my crew a lot of credit. That last stop, we changed rear tires instead of rights or lefts, and I think we outboxed them, you know, because we had a terrible loose race car all day. And we weren't wearing the fronts because of the fact that we weren't using the front. We're just looking. And by putting those 2 rears on and staying out over that last yellow, it gives us enough chance to outdistance them. But we just started the race today with two loose of car. The day got a little sunnier and hotter than we anticipated. It was cloudy this morning, and we just were too loose. But I'd like to thank my crew, Russell, and, you know, Al, and everybody that helped us out here, and Snoozer. You know, and thank Dylan for building me a super chassis. It's a 4-year-old car. I think we had a shot at Milwaukee and then it blew it because of a blown motor. But Kyle Wagner, V6. This is a great day for us. You know.
Well, Dick, we talked earlier today in the beginning of the race about the black book of yours and how well you knew this racetrack. Would you say this was a classic Minnesota race, or was this something that was a little bit different and maybe we added a new chapter to the book?
Well, really, I boxed them today. Normally, you know, I'm a little faster than some of them win the race. We're just terrible losers. We weren't the fastest car today except for the start, but once we changed tires, we're junk, and we outboxed them. And this old track, it can just change, and that's what, remember earlier in the day, I said, if we can chase the racetrack, we can win a race. Well, we didn't do a very good job chasing the track, but we did outsmart them on pit stops, and by putting those 2 rear tires on, I think won a race for us. Really do.
Well, with some crew help like this in your arms here, that really had to help you a little bit today, too.
Yeah, well, I'd like to say hi to everybody out there, and my wife back in North Carolina at home watching the race, and my grandchildren and daughter are here, and my sons are still home, so it's just too bad. I got the race Saturday, the Busch race at Darlington, and then Sunday the Windsor Cup race, and now Monday the ASA race here. So that's a pretty good weekend for me. I got like 1,300 miles of racing on me this weekend.
And a great win for Dick Trickle.
Thank you.
And Daddy's coming home, Trickle family. So batten down the hatches and, you know, get the coffee pot on. Here is the top five finish. Dick Trickle, of course, coming home. The winner, Scott Hansen, second. Bob Seneker, third. Mike Eddy, and then Glenn Allen. Of course, these are unofficial results. Here is what 6th through 10th look like. And we'll be back with more from the Minnesota State Fair after these words where Dick Trickle has been victorious. I suggest that you at home have been very fortunate because the televised ASA races have indeed been a microcosm of the season. We have seen both Seneca and Eddy do very well. We got to see Darrell Waltrip win as well as Dick Trickle. Now here is the remaining schedule. There are four races left on the 1991 ASA schedule. Oswego, New York, Winchester, Indiana on the high-banked half mile, Toledo on the high-banked 7/16th, they call it, so almost a half a mile, and then back to Jennerstown for the final race of the season in the Oldsmobile 400. But it is very interesting that those five races on TV have kind of given you the entire season in a nutshell.
Yeah, they really have, and these races coming up, I mean, these will be significant. We will be bringing you reports. We'll be at those. In 1992, as we said, a minimum of five live races, and, you know, we're not ready to make any formal announcements yet, but some real excitement internationally racing on television next year.
In point of fact, 10 races, we will double what the plans were for the 1991 season, so the national network will be staying with and following the American Speed Association. Well, we did have a second place through 31st or through 32nd place finisher in the 1991 race here at the Minnesota State Fair, and Ralph Shaheen is with the second place finisher.
Well, that second place finisher is Scott Hansen. He's just telling me this car was a tough one for you to drive today.
Well, I'll tell you, you know, we come from just about a lap down. And, you know, Dick just put a lap on us early, and Baker Motorsports crew did a heck of a job. We come in the pits, change tires, and, you know, we decided at the end, you know, should we stay out or come in, and we couldn't tell where Dick was, so we elected to come in, and he stayed out and ran the wheels off, but it just wasn't close enough.
You also had a tremendous battle with Bob Seneker.
Well, we did. You know, Bob was getting out of tires the same as I was, and, you know, we just got in some lap traffic, and he got to the outside a little bit, and, you know, I needed to lead a lap more than anything, and they've been pressuring me for leading them laps for the points, and once we got out front, the car run real good, but, you know, I just got to thank the crew, and, you know, I guess after that win last week to come back and finish second like this, you know, I'm real happy, and the car run real good again, so I know everybody from ASA and, you know, all the drivers want to thank TNN and Group 5 Motorsports for having us here this year, and, you know, hopefully, like they said, we're going to get 10 live races next year, so hopefully we'll be back there to put on some more good shows for everybody.
Well, we hope so too, Scott, because that means Rob and Larry and I get to work 10 more times next year. But you can see, gentlemen, he really had a workout today. He's been standing here for a couple minutes, and he still hasn't caught his breath.
Well, Scott Hansen showing some good timing, coming right on with that promo after the promo. Here is a race summary. Dick Trickle, of course, the winner, averaging a little over 73 miles per hour. We had seven lead changes among five drivers, six cautions for 48 laps. The first two of those were quite long, and 19 cars were still running when the race was over.
Well, certainly a tremendous race this afternoon.
Well, of course, this is part of the future of motor racing. We're talking about ASA being on the national network next year. And part of the future of any motor racing is the rookie crop. And we've been blessed with a very strong one in 1991.
Little did I suspect when I first patrolled the pit area at Winchester Speedway in 1981 that my first ASA interview would be Pat Shower's last. Pat was an enigma a decade ago, showing equal ability in front of the microphone and behind the wheel. Crew Chief Howie Letow remembers Pat fondly.
Well, the thing I remember most about Pat was, besides being an excellent driver and having a great personality, he always took time for the fans, always had time for an autograph.
Shower's fatal crash came in the Winchester 400 in 1981. Running second late in the race, it was a freak accident that would rob Pat of his finish and his life. The Rookie of the Year award was made posthumously. But Pat will never be forgotten. In 1991, four of eight registered rookie hopefuls are battling for the trophy bearing Shower's name and a $10,000 bonus at season's end. 24-year-old Tim Fedewa appears most likely in his DNR Racing Thunderbird. A third-generation racer, Lansing, Michigan's Tim won the Winston National Short Track Championship in 1989. Wearing a perpetual smile, Kenny Adams is a youthful 39. Nicknamed Fireball, the Willowick, Ohio driver of Nick Vitt's Auto Site Pontiac captured two Buckeye State Championships during the 80s. An infrequent ASA competitor in the past, Wisconsinite Terry Baldry secured a full-time ride in the St. Clair Racing Chevrolet for 1991. The quiet veteran of 19 short track seasons lets his right foot do the talking. Surprising, Dean South pilots his own Pontiac. The Dayton, Ohio resident attributes much of this campaign's success to help from front-running youngster Glenn Allen Jr. When the 1991 ASA Rookie of the Year is crowned right here at Jennerstown in October, he will join ranks with some of today's top stars and former Rookies of the Year. Mark Martin, Harold Fair, Kenny Wallace, Ted Musgrave, Scott Hansen, and Johnny Benson Jr. And when Pat Shower's three sons present that big check at the awards banquet in January, it will have been hard-earned.
Tim Fedewa came into this race with seven Rookie of the Race wins. Here are the point standings unofficially at the conclusion of today's race. Seneca and Eddie, you can see Scott Hansen makes it a little tighter. Seneca more breathing room over Mike Eddie. John Benson Jr. holds in fourth position despite a miserable race. And Jay Sauter, he had a bad race. A lot of people, Rob, in the top 10 had bad races today.
Well, certainly things yet to be decided in the four remaining events this season.
Well, we'll be back with more from the Minnesota State Fair, where Dick Trickle reigns supreme. We talked about mom and apple pie. Well, this is Dick Trickle Day, Labor Day, 1991. Well, this huge crowd is filing out of the Minnesota State Fairgrounds. Most all of them are headed for the Midway because the fair is still on. Well, Ralph is now with Bob Seneca. He has been the main man in 1991 up till now, and he has the inside track down to the line.
Well, Bob, you picked up a few points today, but not too many. A tough day for you.
Well, it wasn't too tough a day. Well, finishing third isn't bad. We'd like to have won it, but we kind of missed the setup a little bit, I think, on the Lane Automotive Chevy, and the car was a little bit loose all day. The pit crew did a hell of a job of getting me out in front, but I couldn't hold it all the time. It was just slipping and sliding, and we'll settle for third.
Well, Bob said earlier, gentlemen, that he picked up some points. Not a lot of breathing room, maybe some short gas over Mike Eddy.
Here is the official rundown. Make that unofficial. Trickle, Hansen, Seneca, Mike Eddy prevails for fourth position. Glenn Allen Jr., hey, it's a finish. He's had a lot of disappointments. Sixth through tenth, Tony Raines, another strong top ten performance. Kenny Wallace, despite struggling all afternoon, soldiers home to seventh. Dennis Lampman, another top ten. Great season. Harold Fair was ninth, problems in practice and qualifying. And Ken Stauffer is the tenth finisher.
Finishing in 11th position, local competitor Mark Lamoureux. Tim Steele comes home in 12th. John Olson finishing in 13th position. 14th to John Wilson, former football player Tom Harrington, credited with 15th position this afternoon. And rounding out the top 20, one of our rookies, Dean South, finishes 16th. Jeff Neal, 17th, after being involved in that early race fracas. Tim Fedewa, boy, that's not indicative of his strong performance today. He finishes 18th. Steve Burgess, 19th. And 20th, the Zero Hero, Tom Jones.
Well, we hope you have enjoyed all of these ASA races in 1991, and we'll be back even stronger in 1992. Today's race has been live from the Minnesota State Fair, produced by Kathy McKee. Ken Dennis has been in the truck as our producer, directed by Gary Clem. And the technical manager has been Joel McKee. Well, this has been the first year for ASA to have live television, but it's been a very successful season. Ralph Shaheen down in the pits, Rob Albright and myself up here in the booth are glad that you've been able to join us and remind you one more time that the ASA season is still four races from being over. Now, those races will be documented on the Nashville Network throughout the remainder of the 1991 season. And in 1992, at least 10 live races, possibly some new venues for you to enjoy the American Speed Association. The American Speed Association is definitely part of the future of the motorsport. These are the world's most technologically advanced stock cars, and they are driven by the world's best drivers in that genre. Bob Seneca leads the Minnesota State Fair as the points leader, but it is far from over. Mike Eddy has a legitimate shot. Scott Hansen can still see him, and Johnny Benson Jr. is still holding out hope. And with four races to go and all the top challengers we've had in 1991, you never know. You may have four different winners yet in the 1992 season. the Minnesota State Fair. Special to a lot of people. This has been a special weekend. The Beach Boys on the front straightaway yesterday afternoon and yesterday evening. And Dick Trickle is the last racing driver to leave it this afternoon.